ओके, हरे कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। नमो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वतीदेवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशधारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवाशादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा एवरीवन।
हरे कृष्णा।
आई एम सॉरी, आई फॉरगॉट द फॉर्मेट ऑफ द प्रोग्राम। डू वी जस्ट स्टार्ट रीडिंग फ्रॉम द वर्ड्स? डू आई कंटिन्यू ऑन?
Yeah, Professor, you can start from where you left off last time. 16.4, you had come with three characteristics, and then another three characteristics are remaining.
Okay. So, 16.4. Here we are. तंबो दर्पोभिमानश्च क्रोध पारुष्यमेव च अज्ञानं चाभिजातस्य पार्थ संपदमासुरी। Do it three times or just once?
Definitely.
Okay. Tambo darpo bhimanascha.
Tambo darpo bhimanascha.
Krodha parushameva cha.
Krodha parushameva cha.
Agyanam chabhijatasya. पार्थ संपदमासुरी। दंभो दर्पोभिमानश्च क्रोध पारुष्यमेव च अज्ञानं चाभिजातस्य पार्थ संपदमासुरी। Translation: pride, arrogance, conceit, anger, harshness, and ignorance. These qualities belong to those of the demoniac nature, son of Tha. I think we read the purport last week, right? Did we do that?
Yes, okay. Yes.
So we've done that. So Krishna is speaking of certain qualities that are possessed by people who belong to this category called as Asuri. And we see that these qualities are degrade one's consciousness. So obviously these are not qualities that one aspires for. Nonetheless, since we are trying to seek knowledge, understand the various natures that people may have and how things exist, we are trying to have an understanding of the existential truth. Therefore, it is all right if we try and analyze these unnecessary qualities or unrequired qualities. Uh, Obviously, these are a select few. Krishna felt that with Arjuna just describing these six qualities would be enough to get through the message. The message is, if you can, try and stay away from these unnecessary qualities. Could harm a person and harm others too. So dambha is already addressed last time. Darpa has been addressed, and we also had some discussion on Abhiman. Pride, arrogance, conceit. That's how it has been translated in Bhagavad Gita as it is. We've already seen that how these three words appear to be synonymous, carrying similar meanings, but then there is some subtle differences in how they affect our consciousness. So cha bhi jatasya, they are born, and we will discuss abhijatasya towards the end of, after we've discussed the remaining three qualities, including a little bit about Abhimana. It is interesting how we go into so much depth trying to analyze all that is negative. Somehow or the other, there is this predilection or this inclination to try and understand darkness, to try and understand what is negative. And maybe the justification that if we understand the negative, then we can stay away from it could sound convincing. However, existence in this material world is such that whatever we touch, anything that we kind of access through our senses or our mind, there is some indelible impression that stays with us. Hence, we have to be extra persistent. We have to take extra endeavors to try and cleanse ourselves after we have discussed or after we have spent time with negativity. What is the cleansing process? The cleansing process is that which helps us focus on the progressive values of life. Growth is important for us. Loss or diminution is not really desirable. So the only way we can cleanse our consciousness after coming in touch with, or after our mind has come in touch with negativity, is to envelop ourselves with a lot of positive vibration. We are lucky enough, fortunate enough, that every day we get a chance to dive into positivity through the chanting of the holy names of Krishna. We don't realize, but that is actually very helpful. It heals our mind. So today maybe I'm in a different introspective mood. Who knows? The mind can play tricks. So all of a sudden I'm becoming so very philosophical, introspective. Before I waste any more time, let us go and discuss these qualities now. Oh. Abhiman. We spent some time analyzing what is Abhiman. And I would just want to round it off with a few more observations. So Abhiman is basically that quality which reveals some emptiness within ourselves. We have this hole, this emptiness within ourselves, and the mind convinces us that this hole can be filled up by gaining respect from others. So you can call it our insecurity, you can call it low self-esteem, whichever way you want to call it. Now low self-esteem does not really mean that one is unqualified. It is just that the mind could be tricking us, or the mind is telling us that you are not good enough. So we are not going to discuss about low self-esteem. What I am saying is, when one is desiring to receive respect from others, which is what Abhiman is about, there is this deep desire, there is a strong desire, there is the unrelenting desire to seek validation from others in the form of respect, in the form of gaining respect. It is that inclination where we need others to tell us, oh, you are good, you did well. It's like how at school, even if you stand straight at school, in today's times, you may get a certificate. Good manners, a certificate for your child. It is supposed to boost up the morale of the child. So, that is how it is. Now, as a child, you need morale boosters. As an adult, you need to learn how to live with situations where others may not feel the need that you should have morale boosters. As an adult, you're supposed to have that kind of discrimination. However, when an adult seemingly unconsciously does not have that maturity and is plagued, has sleepless nights over, oh, what are people's opinion about me? Especially social media kicking in. It's all about how many likes did I get, how many comments did I get. And if I received comments, then that could be euphoric. If I did not, then that could not. That could be depressing. So this is Abhiman. That is why it is considered to be a negative quality. It is not just a superficial aspect of one's existence. Yeah, it's just that this person is, always wants others to praise him or her. It's not just that. It arises from this feeling that there is a hole in my heart and others need to fill it. It is not just about one's low self-esteem. It is about being convinced that others need to do this. This is their job. This is their job. So there is the enjoying propensity. However, because one is incapable in certain circumstances to receive that appreciation from others, not just appreciation but respect from others, then the abhiman gets hit. The abhiman is agitated, and it agitates our consciousness, agitates our mind. The quality of abhiman also comes in when one is very deeply attached to one's family connections. If one is very much attached to one's wife or husband, children, oh, my wife did not get this, my child did not get that, my husband did not get this. And then one feels that people have not done their job. They have not properly appreciated my family members. So one takes it very personally. That is also abhiman. So this abhiman, its root is the source, or the place from where this abhiman comes, is the deep attachment to family connections. Through those connections, one fills up that need that one has within oneself, the need to gain respect. This abhiman also arises from the deep attachment that one has to things that one possesses. So it's about cars and people appreciating our cars. It's about our house, people appreciating our house. What sometimes we call as social status. So being affected by how one's social status is reflected in society also shows the need or this deep hunger for having people offer us respect or appreciate us. Although I'm using the word appreciate, as educated people, we have seen that there is healthy appreciation, and one feels good receiving healthy appreciation too. So a question can come to one's mind that is that kind of appreciation also an asuri quality? Well, a healthy appreciation where one is happy receiving appreciation, one feels enthused receiving appreciation, that feeling or need that is being expressed there, that need is considered to be healthy if we can pass on the appreciation to where it belongs. That is what is healthy appreciation. If we receive some appreciation and we can pass it along to where it belongs. Any activity that we perform, we should realize that for the success of that activity, there were so many elements involved. Devarshi, Bhutapta, Nirnam, Pitranam. If you read the Bhagavad Gita, there are five causes for any action. It's not just the self. The self is only one cause. So healthy appreciation and acceptance of healthy appreciation demands that we are trained or we are well versed with passing on that appreciation to where it belongs. Ultimately, as Krishna conscious practitioners, we know that all appreciation should be offered to one's predecessors, one's elders. Like you receive a certificate at school. As a child, the first thing the child does is the child comes and offers a certificate to the elders in the house. You give it to them. Because the child doesn't understand anything more than that. Abhiman has not kicked in for the child as yet. So all that the child realizes is that I got a certificate, I give it to my mother gives me a cookie. I am interested in the cookie, not the certificate. That is what the child understands. So the child comes and naturally in its childish innocence or childlike innocence, it passes on that certificate of appreciation to where it belongs. Because the mother is cooking for the child or the parents, you know, they put the child to sleep, they take care of the child's health, they take care of the child's needs, its bodily needs, monetary needs. So there's so much effort that the parents put in. So that appreciation should be passed on to the entire team. It's a teamwork. So in our regular human relationships, we see that happening. The child does it in its childlike innocence. So healthy appreciation is where we know the art of passing it on to where it belongs. Anything else where we are not able to pass it on, we kind of hold on to it ourselves, it could be a benign form or a malignant form of abhiman. I'm really sorry for being so technical today. I mean, if we Sankhya, that is why Sankhya kind of makes people go crazy. It's like, all right, tell us what is the essence. So the technical kind of makes us aware of situations and it can also scare us. People being scared or being fearful comes in when, one, one feels that one's enjoying propensity is being challenged. But if one has the propensity to be serving others, then this propensity helps us sustain the pressure that comes along when we know so many technicalities. Like someone who does service, there are so many things happening around dynamically around that person, but because the person is focused on service, is unaware of all that is happening around. But if a person is like enjoying an ice cream and is focused on an ice cream, eating it, things happening around, and because a person wants to enjoy, the enjoying propensity makes the person seek other avenues too. This is how enjoyment is. Enjoyment basically means that you're never satisfied. Service would always make you feel satisfied. Doesn't mean that one becomes static. A servant is satisfied doing service. However, the opportunities to do the service are so immense because in this world, most of the population has the enjoying propensity. So as soon as you are satisfied doing service in a particular situation, you have senses, you look around and you find another avenue to do service. So even though you are satisfied because the nature is to do service, you see another avenue to do service, another opportunity to do service, you take it up. So all the occupations where there is an opportunity to do service or sacrifice, you see people going beyond human constraints. But wherever there are situations where one is sitting and enjoying, you find people not going beyond human constraints. Have you ever seen somebody being superhuman wanting to eat loads of ice cream? Have you seen somebody becoming superhuman when they are trying to save people from a burning building? Yes. So that's how, that's the discrimination between service and enjoyment. The enjoyment propensity and the service propensity. So coming back to Abhiman, attachment to family relations like husband, wife, parent, mother, father, child, and attachment to objects. And the greater the attachment, the greater the need is to seek validation from others. Oh, you have a new Mercedes. So validation. You need people to say, man, I really envy you. Something like that. And then you feel that I have a Mercedes Benz. Growing up in India, we, you know, when I was a little boy, there would be this Onida TV. And somehow or the other, that phrase was so catchy. Neighbors envy, owners pride. Wow. So it actually substantiates what we are discussing today. Abhiman is about self-conceit. Although one has this big depressions, holes within oneself, one is in this illusory world where one imagines oneself to be the best person on the planet. One imagines oneself to be as good as God, to be able to receive the worship of everyone else around us. So that is conceit. That Krishna has 64 qualities, I have 63.5. That's the only difference. Everyone else has 6.3 qualities. But me and Krishna, the difference is that I let him be God because his 0.5 qualities more than me. That is self-conceit. So in Abhiman, there is that kind of self-conceit. Because there is the need to be worshipped, right? In the, have respect, receive respect for others. That is a kind of worship. So now if there is a need to be worshipped, one has to be conceited about it. The natural product of that is conceit. So there is this huge self-conceit which forms our existence. And this self-conceit it has a relationship with the qualifications, with the material qualifications that we have, but it is exponentially disproportionate with it. So one may have a certain qualification, like let's say one has a master's degree, or one has, you know, some certificate which says that the best leader for the year 2020 or something like that, the president's medal for doing something, you know, for some achievement. However, when we present that through the media, it's like no one else before me or after me would be as qualified receiving the president's medal. It's like this time when the president's medal was offered, this is like history in the making. It has to go down on this, in the Hall of Fame. That is Abhima. Now, our Hall of Fame may be as big as our washroom. But for us, our washroom is bigger than the world. Therefore, we would bring the person to the to that little place, bring as many people who we feel can validate us, we'll bring them to that place and we'll wait for them. Sir, come on, give me respect for it. So it in this self-conceit is always in excess of one's actual education or one's actual position in society. And somehow one is convinced, when one has abhiman, one is convinced that this bloated pride that we have of ourselves, or this bloated image larger than life that we have created of ourselves, is can actually fill up the lackings that we have. It can fill up the holes that we have within ourselves. That this person is always wanting to receive from others. Very exploitative person. Very exploitative. Asuras are always exploitative. There is deep vanity within this person. This person is always considered or is always concerned about how my image is. Always, you know, the vanity box. There used to be the vanity kit. Typically, I guess it's no longer needed because it's lost its meaning right now in today's world. But in the 1950s, 60s, 70s, people would have, especially ladies, would have the vanity box. What was the vanity box about? Anyone seeing me at any time should always feel that I am a princess. I have just descended from Pari Loka, from Apsara Loka. And what would help me do that? My vanity box. So vanity is about how I should always look not just the best, but I should look divine in the eyes. I should look like a celestial in the eyes of others. That is abhiman. So there is this vanity, and this vanity is due to the delusion that I am so educated. Like one of my friends, let's say in India, someone gets a degree in science, a bachelor's in science, so it is BSc. Now most of you must know this joke, BSc. One of my friends had an interesting degree. He was a very funny person. So he would always say, I have a unique degree. And we would ask him, what is that? He would say, BSc BF. I'm like, what? He said, yes, this is a very unique degree. Bachelor's of Science but failed. And how does it even make sense? But so they are delusional about their education, about their educational status. They feel that from the town they came from, they had the best education, they had the best grades. And when they come to a situation where the best of every town has come in, they become really uncomfortable. They're not able to adjust to that situation. Why? Because there is this vanity in them. The delusion that it's what is called as the Koopa Manduka Nyaya, the frog in the well principle. A frog in the well feels that his well is the best well and there is nothing greater than his well. Because he is the frog in the well. This is his well. So the ocean should also kind of even if it is bigger than the well, the ocean should be, its extent should be measured in terms of its well, like 3 times bigger than the well, or maybe 4 times bigger than the well, not bigger than that. I mean, it's not possible. Why? Because I am the frog in the well. So whatever parameters I decide, that is how things should exist. Why? This vain pride in me, vanity. So one's wealth, one's education, one's birth, and delusions about it give rise to abhiman. Abhiman also makes a person express through one's behavior arrogance. Arrogance basically means that my way or the highway. Arrogance doesn't really take into calculation whether it is profitable or not, whether it is beneficial or not. An arrogant person does not have the capacity to discriminate as to what would be beneficial and what would not be beneficial. An arrogant person is simply pushed by the need to overpower others' opinion, to overpower others' existence. So abhiman also brings forth a lot of arrogance. Especially this arrogance is in relationship to one's concept of what one's self-respect is, one's concept of one's position and status in life. So again, it's a person is in delusion and expresses a behavior that reeks of arrogance, or that exhibits arrogance. So in Chaitanya Leela, there is a personality, Lord Chaitanya's pastimes, there is a personality by the name of Ramachandra Khan. In those days, being born in a Brahmana family, this is about 500 years ago, was considered to be very respectable. So born in a very high caste family, very well educated, had beautiful bodily features, like good enough to be a model, very attractive. And comes in another young man whose head is shaven off, who has put on rags practically. Name is Haridas Thakur. Name was just Haridas, a young man. This young man has become immensely powerful, because there was the young man had a history, and that history revealed the young man's spiritual acumen. So when Haridas comes into this town, Haridas comes to the town of Benapur, Ramchandra Khan is the he is the person who's always on the page 3 of that town. Like, he is the person who's invited to all these social circles. He is the who's who of that town. And comes in an unknown person, comes in a completely, seemingly a derelict person, lives in caves, in forests, and starts receiving invites, more invites than him. Because the people of the town can respect somebody's spiritual status. So everyone wants Haridas Thakur to participate in their functions, to visit their homes. Ramchandra Khan couldn't tolerate that. He was very conceited. He was arrogant. And because of this arrogance, this conceit, this false pride that he had, he wanted to harm Haridas Thakur by destroying his reputation. So he arranged for a young lady to go, and since Haridas Thakur was a renunciate, he arranged for a young lady to go and entice him into a compromising position, which would be captured on camera. What is it called? What did they do? When they kind of sting. This was Ramchandra Khan wanted to do a sting operation on Haridas. I mean, Haridas, he did not have a bank account. He did not even have a house. He did not even own any property. He did not want any followers. And this person who had practically the whole town at his feet wanted to do a sting operation on Haridas Thakur. That is what Abhiman is about. You cannot tolerate the existence of a harmless person if you are convinced that the person should not exist. Arrogance. So he sent this lady and he sent his own men to be witness to Haridas compromising his principles of renunciation. Obviously nothing like that happened, but Ramchandra Khan's example in the Chaitanya Charitamrita is perfect to help us understand what is Abhiman. So that is Abhiman. The next Asuri quality that has been described is Krodha. Krodha, then there is Parushyam and Agyan. So Krodha is a situation in life where Krodha basically means anger, right? However, as an Asuri quality, how does Krodha affect us? How does anger affect us? That is what we are trying to analyze. Krodha leads us to a situation where there is complete lack of control over the mind and its activities and decisions. Under the influence of anger, a person's response would be that I don't care. I don't want to think. I just want to get this deed done. I just want to let my emotions out. So Krodha is where one has total lack of mind control. And when there is a lack of control over the mind, basically it means that we are letting go of the only facility that can help us determine what is to our benefit. We are letting go of our most important friend, guide, tutor, teacher, that is the mind. Because it is the mind which can help us define whether we want to progress in life or whether we want to regress in life. So generally, when there is a lack of control over the mind, a person takes up the regressive path, because the mind is influenced by negativity in this world. So one takes up the regressive path. What makes a person give up control over one's mind? Frustration. When one is frustrated, one stops discriminating. When one is frustrated, one simply wants to let out one's emotions without understanding what could be the consequences. Where does the frustration come from? The frustration comes when we don't have our desires fulfilled. So either it is frustrated greed or frustrated lust. And this frustration makes us forget, makes us it makes us forget how important it is to control one's mind. So having lost control of the mind, now we exhibit anger. Anger gives rise to a lot of animosity. Animosity is a very basic animal tendency. Animosity is not human. Animosity is an emotion, or it is an existence that is revealed by species that have not developed sufficiently, that are on the lower rungs of intellectual development. That is where animosity exists. And as one progresses, as one evolves, one gives up this lower animalistic tendencies. One just lets go of them because they are no longer needed. So what is animosity about? Animosity is about self-preservation at the cost of destroying others. So animals, whenever they find themselves in a situation where they feel there is a danger to themselves, they exhibit animosity. Humans generally don't find themselves in situations like that regularly. Hence, this quality is not needed in evolved beings like the humans. However, anger brings one to that level, that lower level of evolution. And because of such animosity, there is the impetus to injure others or hurt others. There may not be a reason to injure them or hurt them. There could be the need, there could be a feeling that one should injure them or hurt them. However, that may not be helpful. However, when one is under the influence of anger or krodha, these, because one has come down to a lower platform of animal existence, one goes into the survival mode. And what is the survival mode? The survival mode is that for my existence, if someone else's existence has to perish, I am okay with it. Now, krodha brings us to that position. However, the situation in which we are may not be really like that. It may not need an intervention like that. But krodha or anger makes us believe that such intervention is needed. There is a need to injure someone. There is a need to hurt someone. Oh, that person has sought forgiveness, but I really need to hurt that person. Then we can be equal. Because there is anger within ourselves. So anger causes animosity, and it gives impetus to wanting to hurt and injure others. Anger wants us to give pain to others commensurate to the pain that we are feeling. So when anger is there within us, then we feel this burning pain within ourselves, and we want that others should also have similar or more pain. They should also burn. Why? Because I'm angry. That's it. Anger is wrath. Wrath means inflamed emotions. So it's like a burning inferno, wherein there's a lot of antagonism towards others, wanting to harm them. One just feels that somebody is your enemy, and even if God comes and says that that is not an enemy, it doesn't really matter to me. Because there is antagonism. There is this, one becomes antagonistic towards others. That is anger. So that is a kind of wealth that an asura has, anger. Again in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is the example of Haridas Thakur and Gopal Chakravarti. So a family, a very aristocratic family and good-natured people called the Majumdars, they would organize a gathering of scholars wherein they would discuss scriptural subject matters and seek the opinion of very advanced scholars. So they would, and because they were the Majumdars, you know, the who's who of the scholars world would be there in that assembly. The Majumdars had heard about Haridas Thakur and they had heard about his proficiency in spiritual subject matters. So they wanted him to be part of this assembly too. Now Haridas, this is Indian society 500 years ago, where discrimination based on one's birth and one's hierarchical position in society was very rigid. So Haridas belonged to a family, or he was born in a family that was considered outcast. The Majumdars would have scholars come in, and most of them would be from respectable families or very high born families or high caste families. So one such person was Gopal Chakravarti, a decent gentleman, was very well educated, had beautiful bodily features too. Someone that you would want to be friends with. So Haridas Thakur is there. There is a discussion, and for most of the discussion, Haridas Thakur is happy to simply absorb what others are sharing. He just is absorbing all of that. And during the discussion, they come to a point where they are having a discussion about the holy names. And Haridas Thakur, by then, he was completely. His life was just chanting of the holy names of Krishna. He would eat the holy names, he would drink the holy names, he would breathe the holy names, he would sleep the holy names. That was how involved he was with the holy names of Krishna. Especially the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, very involved with that. So somebody, one of the scholars, he said that the holy names of Krishna, they can help you to come to the platform of liberation, but to actually achieve liberation, you'd need some other process. And many scholars, and they gave scriptural references for that, and many scholars felt that this point of view is correct. So Haridas Thakur, he intervened, and everyone was eager to hear his opinion, because this was the first time that he was offering an opinion, and there were some in the assembly that were very respectful towards Haridas Thakur and had heard about him and had dealings with him, and there were others that were not as comfortable being with him, and there were others, and there were a few that were antagonistic. So Haridas, he offered his opinion. He said, the holy names of Krishna are so powerful, the holy names of the Supreme Lord are so powerful, that even if one unconsciously chants the holy names, one is immediately liberated. So the holy names are complete. They are enough to offer liberation and even beyond. As soon as he said that, Gopal Chakravarti, he was incensed. He was so angry. He got up and he started saying, how can you say that? I mean, what is the basis of your assumption? And Haridas Thakur gave references from the scriptures. Harer Naam, Harer Naam, Harer Naam, Evikavanam, Kalav, Nastiva, 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 Gatira, Nitha. The Narendya Puran states that. And there are other references of this from the scriptures. Srimad Bhagavatam says, Aho Bhattasapa Chotam Dariyan. Yet Jivrag, if someone is chanting the holy names of the Lord, one must accept that that person has performed all other forms of Vedic rituals and practices in previous lifetimes. The holy names of Krishna, they completely destroy the sins of millions of lifetimes, just as the appearance of the sun removes darkness from this world, or just as the appearance of the sun, it dissipates the fog that is covering the eyes of people in that particular region. It dissipates the fog. So he gave references, and Gopal Chakravarti was more angered hearing him give supporting references. So Gopal Chakravarti, he started giving his own references, and then he made a claim. He said that if you are not able to substantially prove that the holy names of Krishna offer liberation, even if unconsciously chanted, then, and I give you 3 days for that, and at the end of 3 days, if you are not able to do that, I will cut off your nose. There was no reason for him to be so antagonistic. There was no reason for him to be to exhibit such violence. But he did that. And Thakur Haridas, he humbly said that my faith in the holy names is based on scriptures, and I say that if the holy names of Krishna do not give liberation even when chanted unconsciously, then personally I will cut off my nose. What really happened was that within 3 days, Gopal Chakravarti contracted leprosy, and especially leprosy that affected his nose. His nose melted away. So we see how anger affects one's consciousness, and how it is a negative quality, and what are the forms in which anger is exhibited. The next is Parushyam. Parushyam is the next form that evolves from anger. So Parushyam is connected to anger. However, it is not exactly anger. It is, let us say, anger 2.0 or anger 3.0, something like that. But still, it has its own separate existence. Harshness, that is how it has been translated in the Bhagavad Gita as it is. Harshness. So Parushyam, quality of Parushyam is about harsh, being harsh, but actually it is Parushyam means cruelty, being cruel. And in the light of this understanding of Parushyam, like being cruel, when we take its meaning as harshness, that means you're harshly cruel. It's like cruelty that has hard-heartedness involved with it. Parushyam means one becomes devoid of mercy. One does not want to even consider being merciful. That is Parushyam. Parushyam, it evaporates the quality of kindness from one's existence. because it provokes one to be cruel, harsh, merciless. Now, one also becomes, one lacks kindness. And because one lacks kindness, therefore interpersonal behavior, one comes across as very harsh. Parishyam is also about being rude. So when one is infected by the quality of parushyam, one exhibits rudeness. Especially this rudeness is exhibited trying to put down sadhus or spiritually evolved personalities. And sometimes we can see that there are a few people in the scientific circles that are in the so-called scholar world, the world of scholars. There are a few people that exhibit this kind of rudeness towards people who practice spirituality. Extremely harsh towards them. And these people, I'm not just saying from the field of science, you know, I'm just giving the example that I have experienced in this world. Like, I did meet a few people from the world of science, and just looking at me, they kind of felt that I should not exist. And the reason I should not exist is because most of the problems of this world is caused by followers of religion. Somehow they, you know, they have this extreme left ideas. So I could, from my own personal experiences, I could understand that, okay, this is parushyam. Extremely rude. They feel that we should not exist, because we are the cause of all the problems on this planet Earth. Especially this quality is exhibited when people have positions of power. So rulers, controllers, sovereigns, these places where such people exist, these places, they cause people who are existing in these places to be infected by egotism. Somehow, a position of power, it weakens our immune system to, and with a weakened immune system, one becomes exposed to the virus of egotism. One becomes very egoistic. It's not always there, but especially we see that when there is a position of power or control or authority, that position exposes one to that danger. So hence, parushyam, this lack of kindness, mercilessness, cruelty, harshness, would be a quality exhibited by egoistic rulers, egoistic authoritarian figures. We can see that there are typical examples of there are people like Hiranyakashipu. That is a good example of parushyam. He felt his son should not exist at all. When he was convinced that his son is pro-Vishnu, he just wanted to finish off his son. Very merciless, very harsh, rude to his son, towards his son. Extremely egoistic. He wanted his son to worship him and not Vishnu. He wanted his entire kingdom to worship him and not Vishnu. So what kind of egoism is there? One wants to be worshipped in place of God, not as good as God, but in place of God. They feel that God is a usurper, has usurped their position. They are very belligerent people. They are very rash in their behavior. Very belligerence is one of their, behavioral attributes. Belligerence. Aggressive, warlike behavior. There are people who always exhibit indignation. It's as if, they are always kind of frustrated with how people are not living up to their expectations. That kind of indignation is there. This indignation is actually fake. These are people who, when they are in the washrooms, they realize that they are normal mortals. But outside of the washroom, they are like, I'm God. I'm an immortal. True or false, I don't know, but a story went around in the 1980s, 90s, amongst youngsters, that a very prominent figure of Bollywood, who was a singer, actor, got married to a lady who was very beautiful. Was his second, third marriage, or fourth marriage? After their first night of sleep, the next morning when he woke up and wanted to visit his washroom, before his marriage, he was single. So you kind of just wake up and with eyes closed go into his washroom. So today, he just got up from his sleep, used to his previous experience of being single. He just wakes up, he's kind of just living in that realm. So he walks into his washroom, he finds that the washroom door is closed from inside. And then he realizes that I'm married. I'm no longer single. It hits him. And he's like, oh, I married the most beautiful person on the planet. What is she doing in the washroom? I'm not sure true or false, but it seems that the very idea that she also needed to use the washroom was so catastrophic for him that he filed for divorce. Because his idea of marrying a very beautiful person is that they don't have any bodily needs or functions. They are all beautiful inside and outside. Oh, even she needs the washroom? A mortal? I thought I married an immortal. A celestial. So the dream was gone. So, spurious indignation. Fake. They have not come to terms with their mortality. Like Hiranyakashipu couldn't come to terms with his mortality. Just wanted to live in the world and believe in the world of his immortality. Meticulously and mercilessly, they oppose anything which is correct or right. If it does not fit into their definition of how things should exist, very meticulously and mercilessly, a person who is infected by Parushyam defies, opposes all that which is right. So that is Parushyam. Okay, so 12:07, and we still have one more quality to discuss. Should we stop and open up for questions?
Okay, I think we can finish this quality.
We can finish this quality and get over with this verse.
Yeah.
Okay. So again, is the sixth quality that has been mentioned as Asuri Sampada, the wealth of the Asuras. Again, is ignorance or lack of knowledge which puts us in a position where we cannot discriminate between righteous and unrighteous. We cannot distinguish between eternal and temporary. So that is again lack of knowledge or ignorance of reality that puts us in a position where we cannot distinguish between right and wrong, eternal and temporary. When one is covered over by ajnan, then one becomes a destitute. One becomes a poor person in discrimination. Just as a poor person does not have any money, a person who is covered over by ajnan does not have any discrimination, does not have any powers of discrimination. So one is a destitute in discrimination. Ajnan makes a person feel comfortable being void of knowledge. You know, like sometimes a person who has not had good sleep for many days goes a little crazy and they feel comfortable not eating anything. Similarly, ajnan kind of puts a person in this crazy state of existence where they live comfortably being void of actual knowledge. Because they are comfortable living in this world devoid of actual knowledge, it doesn't really matter to them whether a situation is beneficial or harmful. It doesn't really matter to them whether a situation is helpful or harmful to their own existence. They're completely aloof from it because ajnan has covered it. Ajnan is like deep sleep, completely unaware of reality, of existence. So they are not even concerned about the benefits or harm that can be caused to their own existence. Ajnan is the incapacity to distinguish between the high and low of conducts, principles and values in life. So basically a person in ajnan does not really understand the need of values and principles in life, or if has values and needs, has values and principles in life, if somehow has values and principles in life, really is not able to use them for one's own, for one's benefit. They are tools that practically simply gather dust being unused. So that is ajnan. One is incapacitated, one is unable to use one's quality of discrimination. This was the from Lord Chaitanya's pastimes. We have the example of Jagai and Madhai. Again, at one point of time, because they couldn't find anyone whom they could beat up, they would start beating up each other. At one point of time, because they couldn't shout at any person, or they couldn't blaspheme anyone because no one was around them, they would start shouting at each other and blaspheming each other. They would always be intoxicated too. Therefore, there was no discrimination about what is correct, what is not correct. Once upon a time, they met Lord Chaitanya, and by that time, Lord Chaitanya was famous as, some people accepted him as God descended, some others accepted him as a very spiritually advanced personality. So the news had gotten around, the news had come to them through their intoxicated, inebriated state. They could also, the news had reached them. So when they looked at Nimai, they looked at Lord Chaitanya, they said, they called him by his previous name and they said, "Hey Nimai, we've heard that now you sing and dance. Why don't you do a performance for us?" This is ajnan. They cannot distinguish between eternity, eternal life and temporary existence. They cannot do that. So, dambha darpa vimanascha krodha parushyam evacha ajnanam chabhi jatasya. अभिजातस्य. सो वी डिस्कस्ड, वी हैव ऑलरेडी मेंशन दैट देयर इज अ सिग्निफिकेंस ऑफ द वर्ड च व्हेन इट इज यूज एज चाभिजातस्य. And the significance is that Krishna is saying that these six and many more are Asuri Sampradaya. They are born of somebody who's inclined towards Asuri life. So people make choices, Asuri or Sura. The life of an Asura or the life of a Sura. People make choices. So when they make a choice of the life of a Sura, but somehow, you know, they do that, now they will be benedicted with these qualities, or they would receive this wealth being having chosen and the life of an Asura, an Asuri life. So cha abhijatas, as soon as they make that choice, then these qualities are born. These qualities arise within their consciousness. These qualities cover up their consciousness. So, cha abhijatas. So, lust, greed, perversion, etc., etc., etc. These are other qualities that Krishna has not mentioned, but he doesn't feel the need. He doesn't feel the need to mention them. He just wants us to be completely overwhelmed by these six qualities. Through cha, he says that all the others that you can think of, which are not helpful, which are harmful, which are negative qualities, they are all the sampada, the wealth of the asuras. So cha abhijatasya, when Krishna says abhijatasya sampada asurin, partha sampada asurin, Krishna is saying, what Krishna is indicating is that since these qualities are born within them, please accept them to always oppose scriptural injunctions. Because these qualities are born with their desire to be Asuri, as soon as you desire that, that is what they get. So, because they have these negative qualities, hence, they always oppose scriptural injunctions. And sampadam asurim, parth, parth is Arjuna's name. Basically, it means that your mother Kunti, being a woman living in the forest with five sons, she really was very persistent in taking care of all of you and helping you grow up. So you should be as persistent in growing up. You don't need these qualities touching you. So hence Krishna is calling Arjuna as Partha, the son of Pritha. Pritha is the name of another name for Kunti. So sampada asuri, which means this is their inheritance, this is their treasure, this is their wealth, this is their possession. By saying that, Krishna is indicating that as asuras with such wealth, with these qualities, decorating them, they are always going to hypothecate, always come up with newer and newer ideas of how life should be enjoyed. So they'll come up with new and new hypotheses and engage in heinous activities. Sampada asuri. Basically, society should be protected, and society, especially human society, should be carefully protected and carefully nurtured, that these qualities do not develop in human society. Kali Yuga is a time where asuras along with the asuri qualities exist within the hearts of every living entity. But previously, asuras would live on another planet, far away from human society. So Krishna is saying that this asuri sampada, when one is decorated with these negative qualities, one performs heinous activities which erode all righteousness for all living entities in an attempt to degrade and degenerate all creation. The asura qualities wants to do away with entire creation. They don't want anyone to exist except themselves, and the only reason they can allow someone's existence is if they will wholeheartedly serve them. Otherwise, this species is not needed. Destroy this species. Now, sometimes there is this case of how the planet Earth can do without certain species versus those who feel that every species of life has a right to exist. It's like us, you know, sometimes when we cultivate the land, we feel that the weeds should be taken out and only the crops that give us benefit should be there. So remove all the weeds. Now if it was not our field, it was someone else's field, or if it was a forest, we wouldn't mind the weeds growing. So these asuri qualities, they cause degeneration of all the principles that sustain creation. And hence Krishna is wanting Arjuna to be aware of it. And be safe from it. Stay away from the asuri qualities. So that is asuram, sampadam asuri. So we'll stop there. And any questions or comments?
Question is on the anger, Krodha. This quality definitely is asuri quality. Now, I see there are good examples in Ramayana. Where Krodha is explained and is expressed in the service of Lord. Now, when we say this Krodha is asuri quality, how does the devotee express the Krodha, and how does he possess that one? Is it in reference to some different words, or how does it?
So, can you substantiate what you are saying?
Now, Hanuman, when he was angry,
yes,
and it was light up his tail, and then he burned the Lanka.
Okay,
that was one example.
Do you just want to stick to that example, or do you have any other example?
No, just stick to that first.
So obviously that is one very exceptional example, isn't it?
Yeah,
in the life
of
Hanuman.
It is exceptional, yes.
So, anyways. Have you read the Ramayana? And if you have not, then I would request you to read the Ramayana, because in the Ramayana we would see how Hanuman deals with them. And Hanumanji, after he had burnt Lanka and he jumped into the ocean to put off the fire on his tail, he expresses his realization that I burnt the whole city of Lanka and Sita is also within Lanka. How could I do that? And he says, this is what happens to a person when the person is angry. They lose discrimination. I did not even consider the fact that maybe I should make some preparation for Mother Sita, keep her safe before burning Lanka. I just went around burning Lanka. That is what Hanumanji says. And then he says that, however, I can be reassured of her safety, because this fire is burning the whole city of Lanka, but the fire did not burn my tail. And the fire could not touch me. The only reason the fire could not touch me and burn me is because Mother Sita has blessed me. And if by her blessings the fire did not burn my tail, then most definitely the fire could not touch her tail. So that is how Hanumanji, he responds to his exhibition of anger. And if we feel that, you know, maybe it is justified, because sometimes we say that anger can be used to serve the Supreme Lord, if we are justified, then the reason to justify anger is when the service is as important. Whether service demands, or whether service is because Mother Sita has been kidnapped, she is in Lanka, and burning Lanka could give a signal to Ravana. This is just a trailer for the movie that is about to come. So if there is a situation like that, then maybe the exhibition of anger is justified. At the same time, we also have to understand how Hanumanji felt about it, which has been revealed by Valmiki ji in the Ramayana.
Thank you for it.
You are welcome.
Wonderful. Last Ramji, one question that I have. So this verse says, and you also explained, Ramji, that these asuric qualities develop or cover the consciousness as soon as one becomes asurically inclined.
Yes.
So question is, how can one become asurically inclined? Because as we evolve from lower species to higher species, generally that is not the intention. Is it because of past karma and the desire, the malicious desire? How can this intention itself develop?
The inclination towards an asuric life can be understood in the context of how the spirit soul, the pure spirit soul, makes the decision of going away from Krishna. It's a matter of choice.
So the more envy a jiva or jivatma has towards Krishna, the more asuric qualities.
That would definitely make the living entity inclined more. However, past karma or maybe the curses of other living entities or anything else can only work when the living entity exists in their area of influence. Only when the living entity is in this material world would they have an effect on the living entity. Okay? And the living entity existing in this material world can only be justified because of the living entity's desire to be in this material. If the living entity desires to be free of this material world and leave this material world, all the past karma can stay here, no problem. Yes, that is what Krishna says, no? Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayami. Yeah, there may be so many sinful reactions, do not fear. I'll pick you up, take you there, then let them resolve it amongst themselves.
So then the only hope for such a living entity is the mercy or the prayers of other devotees, because that living entity doesn't know, and because most of these qualities, they are, you said that they are happy being in ignorance or being devoid of knowledge, being in abhiman, they don't realize that this is a bad quality. So what is the hope for such a living entity?
we'll have to give credit to Krishna's plan. When Krishna has arranged this material world and he has put in the mechanisms of this material world, if the living entity is evolving through various species, from the lower species to the higher species, when the living entity comes to the human species through such evolution, the living entity is given the opportunity to be aware that now one can make decisions now. Animals don't have that opportunity. Therefore, the scriptures say, Athato Brahma Jikhnyasa. Now you should choose to inquire about the Supreme Truth. It says Jikhnyasa. It doesn't say Athato Gurujana Ashirvad. It doesn't say Athato Bhagwat Ashirvad. Now in this human form, you should receive the mercy of Bhagwan. You should receive the mercy of devotees. It doesn't say that. The Vedanta Sutra says, now that you have the human form of life, inquire about the absolute truth. Which basically means Krishna's plan and his mechanism of evolution in this material world is such that as soon as a living entity comes, once again evolves, and evolution is natural. As soon as you die as one lower species, you go to a higher species. That is the way evolution happens. And it ends at the human species, where again you decide where you want to go. In the lower species, you cannot decide where you want to go. You can go only one way, up. That is Krishna's arrangement. That is his plan for this material world, the way it works. In the human form, one is given the opportunity, one has that realization that one has the opportunity, one has the intelligence to make choices. Like an animal, you bring it to your house, you bring it to a temple, you bring it to a well, you bring it to an abandoned palace. For the animal, it is simply about, where can I sleep? Is there food available here? But as soon as a human is brought to any of these places, a human realizes that there is so much potential in this place. What is the temple about? A human makes an inquiry. Correct?
Yes.
So that is the benediction of the human form of life, the human species. Is it all right?
Yes.
So what is it, whether we should pray for this or pray for that? Most importantly, we must do something, make choices. So if you want to make if you make the choice of wanting to pray for blessings, you can go ahead and do that. If you make the choice of seeking blessings and also understanding, you could go ahead and do that. Amongst his asuri qualities, do all of them coexist in every person, or is it that one evolves into another, one gives way to another? This is called as kutarka. Now what is kutarka? Kutarka means trying to analyze that which cannot be analyzed. Does it really matter? Isn't Parushyam in itself enough for us? Or Krodha? Because every quality is harmful. Krodha is total lack of mind control. You don't want to be there. Parushyam is harshness, cruelty. You don't want to be there. Well, as an asuri existence is very fertile for these qualities to grow. What one, like Hiranyakashipu, we say is lust, because there's predominance of lust. Hiranyaksha, we say greed. So maybe there is more elements of greed than lust in Hiranyaksha. There's more. Hiranyakashipu also was hoarding wealth. But it seems the element of lust was more than greed. That is always possible. It is always possible how many spoonfuls of which quality you take onto your plate. Okay. However, when you choose this hotel, then these are the suites that I, Parushan suite, or Krodha suite, these are the facilities available. Where you want to spend the night? Okay, can we stop here? Is there anything else? Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.